Click the record button here. That's very important. I just have a few brief housekeeping items before we get started. First off, as always, we're offering an hour and a half of CME credit, and we need to let you know that the speaker disclosed an ownership interest in MetaBid, and the organizers had no relevant financial interests to disclose. And claiming your CME credit will require filling out a post-event survey that we will email to you after we adjourn. I know last week's post-event email got stuck in spam filters for many people or got stuck in some other internet filters that wasn't allowing it to make it to the destination. Not for everybody, but for a large number of people. So if you had trouble getting last week's email and didn't get your CME certificate, please just let me know and we'll take care of that. And likewise with this week, if you don't receive the post of an email, please just let me know. So be thinking of your questions. We'll have plenty of time for Q&A.
Hey, lovely.
And you can use the Q&A button in the toolbar to submit a written question, or if you'd like to verbally ask your question, please just click the raise your hand button and we'll unmute you so you can ask your question verbally. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn the webinar over to our executive director, Dr. Jane Orient, who is going to help us with the introductions tonight. Thank you so much, Dr. Orient, for kicking us off and for all your efforts for patients in the profession. Dr. Orient, welcome to our Doctors Are In webinar.
I'd like to welcome everybody and thank Ralph Weber for being with us once again. He has given excellent talks at many of our meetings. He is the author of the little book MediCrets that we have distributed through AAPS. That's a little gem. He has many initials after his name that I won't try to interpret for you, but he is the founder and the president of Route 3 Benefits and is the designer of many types of benefits and insurance plans for employers and has been invaluable to us in answering many of the questions that have come up. We're trying to understand what's going on in the obscure world of insurance. Mr. Weber is a pioneer in price transparency. He is the founder of MediBid.com. Some of you may have had some experience with that. It is a way for patients and doctors to deal directly with each other, looking for personalized care, particular types of procedure at an agreed upon upfront price. So if you have not participated in that, you might want to look into that after the meeting. I don't want to take any more of his time. So Mr. Weber, why don't you take it away?
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Orient and Jeremy. So happy to be here again. I wish that we could have had the St. Louis and San Antonio meetings. I miss seeing everybody in person, but at least we're together virtually. So tonight, my talk is on transparency. There's a big thing about transparency. Everybody's talking about it. So I'm going to start the presentation. Jeremy, I want you to let me know that, you know, make sure that my slides are advancing.
Yep, looks good.
And showing. Okay, good.
Will do. I'll let you know if there's a problem. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So the first question, why transparency? Why all the buzz? President Trump had some transparency orders. Obama before him, everybody's talking about transparency. Some of the insurance companies don't like it, or do they? We don't know. So the first question is, why transparency? If you knew the price of something before you bought it, would it change your behavior? That's the big question. So if you go to a restaurant and you see one bottle of wine for $38 and another for $380, would that influence your choice? If a hospital charges $10,000 more than your deductible and another charges $80,000 more than your deductible, would that influence your choice? Is that a different question? So let me pause for a quick video and then we'll get started. Now, let me just see if we can get this started here. I will maximize the video and start it. We just tested it and it seemed to work. So just bear with me here a second. Maximize and start.
The U.S. spends more per capita than any other country in the world on healthcare. The U.S. spends more per capita than any other country in the world on healthcare. Usually when people buy things in the U.S., they assume that the more you pay, the better the quality. And that's the case in most aspects of the economy. But in healthcare, it's almost the exact opposite. Well, it's interesting because the way our healthcare system is set up, there's an inverse correlation between cost and quality in the US. As a matter of fact, very often, the more you pay, the lower the quality. Let me illustrate. Let's say you have two doctors, an experienced surgeon that does 500 procedures a year and an inexperienced surgeon that does, let's say, five. Take the experienced one. He might take 25 minutes to do a knee replacement. If he comes across a complication, he's seen it 100 times, he's got no problem, you're still in and out in 30 minutes. Now, both the hospital and the anesthesiologist bill by 15-minute units, so you only have half an hour of time. The inexperienced surgeon might take 2 hours to do the same knee replacement, and if he comes across a complication, he's got to call in another doctor, has to come in and scrub in. You're under anesthesia for two, maybe two and a half, or 3 hours. And you've got more OR time, more anesthesia time, and because you've been under anesthesia for over 2 hours, maybe even three, you might even need one or two nights overnight in the hospital. So those bills all add up. So that's why you have an inverse correlation. Why don't people notice it? In the US, most of us think about our deductible or copay only. And if you have somebody that has, let's say, a $5,000 deductible, and they have a choice between two surgeons, the charges for the experienced one might only be $30,000 because of the relatively small amount of time in the operating room, while the inexperienced one is going to have charges of maybe $90,000. And if people see only those two surgeons and the prices, and they know they're out $5,000 with either one, chances are they're going to choose the one that has higher charges. So that's why our system almost encourages higher spending.
Oops, let me just go back. Okay, so let's go back to this question here. If one hospital charges $10,000 above your deductible and one charges $80,000 above your deductible, would it influence your choice? Often it does in the wrong way. Now, we all know that insurance companies make money, the more you spend, the more they make, because they have a percentage, thanks to Obamacare, with the medical loss ratios, where 15 to 20% of everything you spend, they keep as their operating margin. So they actually want you go to more expensive care, an MRI versus an X-ray, name brand versus generic, inpatient versus outpatient, et cetera. So the transparency question is very important. Most employers that I talk to, when I say, what kinds of things are you doing to decrease your healthcare costs? They'll say, well, I want to make my employees consumers. And then I ask, well, how do you do that? They'll usually say, well, I have a health savings account so that they're spending their own money. And that's a great strategy, works really well until you hit the deductible. But then after the deductible, you have this other phenomenon. Meanwhile, the insurance companies with PPO networks try to restrict competition. Every self-insured employer has an ASA, which stands for Administrative Services Agreement. And it not only restricts, but it prevents you from auditing your own claims. And this is an actual excerpt from an actual ASA. And it says, the parties acknowledge that the employer may not contact network providers directly regarding the rates or charges for services provided to the members through that part of the plan administered by, and behind this black box is the name of the insurance company. All such contact with network providers must be by and through the name of the company. Again, what this does, it prevents you. It's like saying, okay, because this is a self-insured employer agreement, so the insurance company is spending the employer's money. But the insurance company is also saying, you can't ask Dr. Orient how much she charged and how much we paid her. You can't ask Dr. Smith. You can't ask Dr. Held. You can't ask any physician or hospital how much of your money we spent. So they block competition. They block competition, but they also block transparency. So this is an interesting slide. This is in Oklahoma City. This is the actual price for a knee replacement. This is going back about 3 years ago now. Now, This is the Medicare rate for knee replacement, $14,682. One hospital has, and these are allowable charges. This is not, you know, charge master. This is what they're actually paid. Hospital A, $16,949. Hospital B, $95,799. Now, the Medibid target price range is $18,886. Now, the interesting thing is, although this slide was from 3 years ago, right now, today, our average is $17,341. So it's actually come down through transparency and competition. Because what's happened is as people become efficient, as they do more of a procedure, and most of you on this webinar, I'm sure, are physicians, and you know that a procedure that you do today in 15 minutes might have taken you an hour when you just got out of medical school. So when you think of all the charges, the hospital OR time, you know, anesthesia time, et cetera, those charges are greater for a procedure that takes a longer time. So the hospitals, of course, thrive on that. And that's why they're buying up so many practices. So this is really important. And to me, this is really fundamental in understanding really the fundamentals of paying for healthcare. So how many kinds of money are there? There are two kinds of money, according to Milton Friedman. Your money and my money. That's it. Two kinds of money. How many ways are there to spend money? There's me spending my money. There's you spending your money. Me spending your money. And you spending my money. Okay, so these two slides are really, really important because when I started Medibid, somebody told me, oh, your model is just like Priceline. This is great. Just, you know, use it with insurance and people will always shop for the more cost-effective, you know, option for care. Now, if you're spending your own money, that is absolutely the truth. But if you're spending my money, again, pretending that I'm Blue Cross, if you're spending my money, you don't care. As a matter of fact, in some cases, you're motivated to spend more. So sometimes, and just recently, with all of this healthcare transparency legislation, we're getting people that are saying, hey, you know, maybe we could use this to our advantage. So some of the legislation that has happened, several states and the feds have mandated that hospitals post prices. So what are prices? Just because they say, you know, our price for X procedure is $10,000, KneeScope, for example, that doesn't mean that they will accept that from Jeremy or from Ralph or from Bob or Sally for that procedure. And the legislation doesn't require, at least I have not yet seen legislation that requires them to post, here's what I will accept. Now, we all know and love Dr. Keith Smith. He actually does that, as well as many of his followers now. He actually says, hey, here's my price. And it's, as a matter of fact, let me see if I can remember this. I think it's $8,625 for a cholecystectomy, if I'm not mistaken. But he just posts that out there. This is my price. This is what I will accept. That is true transparency. Some of this legislation, it's like if the government legislated that everybody must smile, you know, what would that produce? So Monroney stickers, let me just talk about that for 2 seconds. And many of you have heard me talk about this before. Senator Mike Monroney was a senator in the state of Oklahoma in 1955. And he passed legislation which basically on cars right now, if you go to a car dealer and you see the MSRP posted on the window, that used to be called a Monroney sticker because it was because of Senator Monroney's legislation that all car dealers had to post that. Before that, you can go literally from, and of course this is way before internet, 55, I think, Jeremy, was that was before Al Gore invented the internet, right?
Yeah, I think so. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
I think you're right on that one.
So before, you know, Al Gore invented the internet, you could go from one dealer to the other and have vast differences in pricing. So the Monroney stickers required that to be posted. So that way the consumer had complete information. So I'm going to just jump through this. I had this here as backup in case the video didn't work. So I'm just going to jump through this. And we've already spoken about it. It's very interesting because sometimes it will get the average uneducated consumer to make the wrong choice, the right choice for the insurance company, the wrong choice for themselves. Now, I put together some statistics. The average deductible today in the U.S. is $4,364. If you Google how many Americans can afford $400, actually, how many Americans cannot afford $400 for a medical procedure, the answer will come back 42% of Americans cannot afford $400. So $4,300 is, it, you know, for a lot of people, it might as well be a million. And only 13% of Americans actually spend more than $4,000 per year for medical care. But because of the chargemaster game, most of them think that they're actually spending over $10,000 because of the lack of transparency, because of the chargemaster versus the allowable charges. So only 87% of people, I'm sorry, that's incorrect. Only 13% of people pass the deductible of $4,364. I put that wrong. But the top 5% of people spend over $20,000 per person. So in terms of controlling costs, a lot of people say, you know, let's have transparency. That's going to solve the problem. It'll solve the problem for 87% of the people, but that expenditure is very, very low in terms of the total spend. Excuse me. So let's talk for a minute about the some of the lawsuits that are going on now that have started and are ongoing. Cigna, there was a lawsuit, a RICO lawsuit filed against Cigna in January of this year. And basically, they were accused of racketeering, the RICO Act, brazen embezzlement, and conversion scheme. So here's what they have done. Let's take a self-insured employer, ABC Widgets. Somebody goes for a procedure, and the bill charges are, let's say, $50,000, and let's say the allowable charges for that procedure, $35,000. That insurance company will actually pay more than the $35,000, sometimes even more than the $50,000. So let's say they pay $60,000, which is $25,000 more than the allowable charges. They'll actually pay that. Or at the very least, they'll take that money from the employer's account and put it in their sweep fund, and they'll say, we've got to pay this hospital and doctor for this procedure. The employer has that money removed from their account, and at the end of their plan year, they're told, you paid $60,000 for this procedure. And they say, okay, that's fine, whatever. They don't have the right to audit their own claims, remember? So that money's already been taken, and they just don't even think about it. A year later, somebody that might be on a fully insured plan goes for a knee replacement to that same hospital, and that same insurance company will say, hey, listen, we overpaid you by $25,000. So instead of paying you the allowable charges of $35,000, we're actually only going to pay you $10,000. That happens all the time. And that's called cross-plan offsetting. They offset the cost from one plan to another. It's illegal. It is totally illegal, but it happens all the time. And that's what this lawsuit against Cigna is about. Recently, and by recently, I mean with, and you know, these are current cases. Cigna is this year, 2020. This was just settled about a month and a half ago. Blue Cross reach a tentative antitrust settlement for $2.7 billion. So once this is finalized, several Blue Cross companies, including Anthem, WellPoint, et cetera, will pay $2.7 billion to settle this claim. That was not a judgment. That's them just saying, hey, look, we're going to pay this. We just want to make this thing go away. So we see these really big insurance companies where there is a complete lack of transparency. there's a complete lack of accountability. There's a complete lack of employers being able to audit their own claims to see how their money's being spent. And again, 76% of Americans outside of Medicare, Medicaid, and the VA, of those privately insured, 76% of Americans are self-insured through an employer-sponsored health plan. And in those health plans, the big insurance companies will administer most of these plans, and they are spending your money as an employer with no accountability. Again, keep in mind, they make money on margin. So the more they spend, the more they make. Earlier, actually, it was last year now, we wrote a bill in the state of Tennessee for their state employees. There are 139,000 employees, roughly 280,000 individual members that are covered by the state health plan. They had $2.7 billion in billed charges, $1.6 billion in paid claims. We looked at their claims. Over 360 million exceeded the median by more than 100%. So what that means, if the median for any given procedure is, let's say, $600, the $360 million is those that exceeded double that. So more than 101% above the median. Physician charges alone, there were $17.8 million in overpayments. Now, let's talk about that two lines from now. In addition, there were $22 million in questionable claims, 96,000 claims, only physician charges. This isn't even including the hospitals. This was the easy audit to do. Once we include the hospitals, you can multiply that by 4 to 5. 96,000 claims were paid at more than billed charges. Now, how many have we got on this webinar? We've got 87 people. How many people here, and Jeremy, can we call for a show of hands? How many people here have actually sent a bill to the insurance company and been paid more than you billed? I'd like to see how many people.
Yeah, so if you've been paid more than you billed, please click the raise your hand button so we can get not many hands. I don't see many hands to that one.
No? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, 96,000 in 2018 in Tennessee were paid more than their charges. So, that's very interesting. And why would they pay more than billed? Again, you know, as I spoke about a couple of minutes ago, cross-plan offsetting, they will, pay more, or at least appear to pay more. And again, this was a mini audit. Did they actually pay that, or did they just say they paid that? I don't know. The Attorney General currently has an RFP out for an audit, for a full audit on the state health plan as a result of our legislation. So I'm going to show this quick video. This is a 5-minute video, and then after that we'll have the polling question. Let me see if I can undo my pointer so that I can actually click on this link. How do I do that, Jeremy? Let's see here. Here we go. Okay. Another video.
Okay, we've analyzed $2.7 billion of claims from the state of Tennessee employees and teachers and higher education. And I just wanted to look at three different procedures to see what some of the variance is. As you can see here, this is repair of knee joint. We see a little green section, a yellow section, and a red. The red is excess charges. When we zoom over here, we'll see the median cost is $4,731 and the maximum is $75,000. So let's go ahead and click on the graph and see if we can look at some of the data. Now, when we float over here, what we'll see is there's a green money bag near the top right that says medical spend $75,000. So, you know, those are pretty high charges for repair of a knee joint. And as we float down to different procedures, we're down to 42,000, 40,000, 25,000, et cetera. So we see a lot of them that have really excessive charges. When we go down towards the lower charge providers, we're seeing 6,400, 6,477, we're seeing 6,488. So there's a lot, there's really a ton down here that are under $7,000. More than half of them are under $7,000. And once we get to 8,500, you know, we're going to see all of a sudden it starts spiking up again to 20,000, 25, 30, 40, up to $75,000. Now we're going to look at a fairly common procedure, a colonoscopy. So in a colonoscopy, again, we see the green, which is the base charges, and the yellow, which is the tolerance, and then the red, which is the excess charges. When we float over here, we see the median cost is $1,212. When we click on the graph, we're going to bring up some actual incidents. Now, if we look at the top one, somebody actually paid $17,341. Now, the interesting thing is, if you look towards the bottom of this little pop-out window, under it says medical rating. This is rated by CMS, which is Medicare and Medicaid, and it's rated 2 stars out of 5. If you look below, the mortality is in the red, the safety is yellow, readmissions, effectiveness, and patient experience are all in the red. Now let's just float down and keep your eyes on the medical rating. Here's 3 stars. This is not rated. This is 3 stars, 2 stars, 2 stars, 2 stars, 2 stars. So you can see the quality rating in most of these higher ones are 2 and 3 stars. Now let's just zoom over to the sort of the lower cost ones, and let's look at this. Look at this. This is a 5-star in terms of quality. 5-star, 5-star, 5-star. We're going among these 5 stars. So all of these providers, these are $3,691, you know, et cetera. And these are all 5-star providers. So the higher quality providers are actually charging less. And if you look at this, the safety is green, the readmissions is green, the effectiveness and mortality is yellow, but the patient experience is green. So what we're seeing is when the lower cost providers are rated higher, there's you know, better quality delivered at that price. So now we're looking at a CT scan of the abdomen. Again, we see a very small green bar, very small yellow bar, but very large red. If we float over here, we'll see the median cost of a CT scan is $635, but the high cost is $19,800. So let's jump into this graph and look at some individual incidents for CT scans. Now, at the high end, here we go. Here's $19,800, as you see in the green money bag in the top. And as we look at different procedures, again, look at the medical rating of quality. They're all, there's a bunch that are 3 stars, 3 stars, 3 stars, 3 stars. There was a 4 there, but they're all 3. Now let's look at the lower cost ones and look at the quality. 4 stars, 4 stars, 4 stars. So the lower cost are actually higher quality. So we're spending a lot of money getting lower quality on CT scans. These are $11,000. Now that's really high for a CT scan, but what does come through very, very clearly is generally there's an inverse correlation between cost and quality. Now these ratings are done by CMS, which is Medicare and Medicaid Services. All of the 4 stars provider are on the lower end of the scale. And when you look at the higher cost ones, the ones that are 19,000, et cetera, these are, you know, 3 stars mostly. So why is it that we're paying more for 3 stars than we are for 4 stars? So there's a big inverse correlation. And when we look to analyze the spending by the state of Tennessee taxpayers, there's a big discrepancy.
Okay, so It's very interesting. Again, when you understand that two things, number one, the insurance company makes money on margin. The more you spend on a procedure, the more they earn. So they want to steer you to somebody that has higher allowable charges. Number two, because most people, transparency, as I said earlier, it definitely works if you're spending your own money. But if you're spending somebody else's money, sometimes the exact opposite is true. You actually spend more. So lately, the insurance companies have been investing in transparency companies that will display just the cost, because they're hoping that if you see one hospital has charges of 90 versus another one with 60, you'll choose the $90,000 one because they'll make more money. You can really see their motivation. This next slide here shows a little bit more on this particular audit that we did. And this digs really deep into it. The charges for this particular procedure, let me just see what I can, I forget what this procedure was, but in any case, the charges for the state of Tennessee state employees were $56,000. The market value of these charges was, $56 million. The market value was $5 million. 72,000 claim lines were paid, and $22 million was paid when it should have been $5 million. So roughly four times the market value. If you look at this map, it shows the green, the yellow, the orange, and the red. It shows the hospitals, the ambulance, the individual physicians, you know, et cetera. So you can really drill down. You can see the mortality level, the safety, readmissions, effectiveness, patient experience, and the CMS rating. So what we did is we measured the healthcare waste index on this procedure. It was 36.3%. So we see that there's a lot of healthcare waste. So that leads us to the question, how do we make healthcare more sustainable? Number one, most important thing is we have to put the patient in charge of their own spending. Number two, we've got to give them a budget. Now, we need insurance for the big stuff. Nobody is denying that. But we also know that healthcare in the U.S. is not real insurance. So we've got to take some money for premium and then say we're going to cover, you know, so many procedures at such and such a budget. But then what we do is we make them pay the difference if they exceed that. So if a business were to send an employee on a business trip and they stayed in the Ritz-Carlton or the Waldorf Astoria, that business wouldn't pay. So you say, here's what we're paying for. We're paying for the Hampton Inn. And if you spend more, then you pay the difference. Then we let them keep the difference if they come in under budget. So if they are actually seeking cost-effective care, we put an incentive in there for them. And of course, we have to provide them, a shopping tool with transparency that helps them to find those cost-effective venues and sometimes different modalities for that. So, Jeremy, can you go ahead and post the poll now?
Yes. Yeah, so I'll put the poll up here. So everyone, yeah, you should see the poll here. You please vote if you would. There we go, some votes are coming in. Do you see the results popping up on the screen there?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Ralph, right?
Yep.
I think probably the attendees do as well. Attendees, mm-hmm. Are you seeing the results pop up on the screen? If you do, just could you type something in the chat room there? The attendees are not seeing the results.
Okay.
Interesting. Okay. So I think when I click in polling, I think probably that there's an in polling button. And when I click that, I think then attendees will see the results. All right, it looks like the voting slowed down. So
61% have voted, it looks like, yeah. 62%.
Some people may not be able to vote if they're on the phone, or maybe it's difficult because they're in a car or something watching.
Sure,
people.
Yep.
Okay. So that's a pretty good turnout, 66%. Well, not quite as good as the number that turned out in Wisconsin, but which I think, all right. So I'm going to click in the poll here, and I think let me take a screenshot of it just in case I've never done this. So thank you for being our guinea pigs here, everybody.
Yeah, let me see if I can bring this up. in front of my slide. Can you see it?
Yeah, here. Let's see, I think I have to click in polling, which I'll do.
Oh, I see.
Okay, there we go. So I clicked in poll, and then now there's a share results. Okay, now I think everybody can see the results.
Okay, but just wait, Jeremy, I've got a question.
Oh, sorry.
Can we still count the polls after they, if they come in after you close the polls?
I don't know. This is kind of a beta test here, so I'm not sure. So you want to do it again? You want to ask them?
No. I was just kidding.
Oh, I see. I got it. Ha ha. Yeah.
Okay.
I haven't learned how to rig the results yet. So.
Okay. So the vast majority are saying that widespread transparency will reduce costs by 50% or more. And then the second most common answer, 25 to 50%. And maybe, you know, if we had refined the question a little bit, we might have gotten a different answer. If we had said transparency and cost alone, I think that nobody answered incorrectly, because it will definitely increase costs for 87% of the people that are below their deductible. No question at all. But for those people that are above their deductible, it'll actually do the opposite. So, and this is interesting, because when the question is posed this way, and pollsters know how to really, you know, ask a question, they know how to, you know, get it to give the results that they want. So, again, it will reduce costs for the individual that is below the deductible, but it'll probably, on the large scale, my feeling is that will increase results. And the reason I say that is I actually know some companies that added a tool called Healthcare Blue Book to their health plan. Nothing else, just Healthcare Blue Book. And they said, you've got the Cigna or the Blue Cross or whatever network, and we're going to add Healthcare Blue Book so that you can see the prices. People shopping for a procedure that's less than their deductible, CT scan, you know, et cetera, were actually price conscious. Those that exceeded their deductible were not. So in some cases, it can actually increase their costs. So there's no one magic answer. It's a long answer, but that's interesting. So do we have any questions, Jeremy? Did you want to open it up for questions?
Yeah, let me just click the stop sharing here. And we do have a number of questions. And
okay.
All right, you're ready to go to Q&A? All right.
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, Ralph, for the very enlightening presentation there and for putting this together for us tonight here. So just a quick reminder that if you'd like to ask your question verbally, click the raise your hand button and we'll unmute you to ask your question. Otherwise, please go ahead and type it into the Q&A box over in the side. And I'll keep my eye up for raised hands. I don't have any just yet. And just a note, if you type it in the chat box, we may not see it quickly. So if you do have a question that you want to submit in a written fashion, click the Q&A button. So I'll start with the first one that came in here. And this attendee mentions that they're taking a very expensive drug for which they pay a small copay. But for the last 5 years, they've gotten a large check in the mail from their insurance company at the end of the year, accompanied by a letter notifying the patient that they're being reimbursed for overpayments during the previous year. And they're saying they never cash these checks. So they're wondering if there's some funny business going on between the insurance company and the drug company, or why that's happening.
Okay. I'm happy to address that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Most PBMs, and I know Bob Campbell talks a lot about PBMs. Most PBMs receive pay a rebate. And I'm going to give you a real live example. Harvoni, Hep C drug, costs about $96,000 for a 6-month course of treatment. It's 92% effective for Hep C. Cigna receives roughly a 50% kickback or rebate on those drugs. So some of the big insurance companies will say our administration fees are really, really, really low, but then they actually receive those rebates as profit and keep it as profit. Last year, there was a new hep C drug called Mavyret, and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that correctly, which only cost roughly $28,000. Even with a 50% rebate, half of 28 is nowhere near half of $96,000. So Cigna actually would not allow that on their formulary. Some PBMs will actually pay those rebates directly to the patient that gets those drugs. And again, it varies from insurance company to insurance company, PBM to PBM. So those people that actually get the rebates, that's called, you know, pass-through, which is a good thing. So if you're getting a check, which is a rebate, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, that's the right thing to do.
Right, would be to cash it. I mean, the person should cash the check. Yeah.
Yeah, because that's what it likely is. It's a rebate from the drug manufacturer.
Right, and that's good that it's, I mean, right, we need more of that, more of the passing through.
Ultimately, what we should just do is sell them at, you know, cost plus a profit, right, instead of like 10 times the profit, yeah, and that, you know, like mark it up 100, you know, times and then give back 50% of that.
Right, the rebates, this whole rebate game creates too many ways to skim money and pocket
absolutely
money. That's not, doesn't add value to anybody except the middleman.
Absolutely, exactly, yep.
Okay, we got a raised hand here. So let's see, this is Abigail. I'm going to click the button to allow you to talk. You may have to confirm that on your end. But Abigail, welcome to the webinar tonight. You may need to
unmute yourself.
Unmute, yeah, so there should be a prompt coming up asking you if you want, there you go. All right.
There we go.
Hi.
Sorry about the delay there.
No worries.
I was typing away in the Q&A box, but it's much easier to ask it directly. Pioneer has an ongoing study for Massachusetts price transparency law. Last I saw, they find that it hasn't made much impact on the public ability to access hospital prices. I'm wondering if you have any comment on that, if you're familiar with it. And also, just seeing their work has always made me think that there is an underlying reason that hospitals are exempt from price transparency laws. Usually, I mean, most people have to post their prices. You can't just walk into a shop and find things without prices.
Sure.
So what's your take on all that?
That's a great question, Abigail, and very valid. You know, and as I said earlier, price transparency laws, there's a huge discrepancy. If the government says you have to post prices, well, what do you post? Do you post your charge master? Do you post what you get paid by Blue Cross, United? Do you post what your cash price is, what the Medicare reimbursement rate is? It's usually undefined. They usually say for the top 25 procedures, for the top three payers, post your prices. You know, again, that doesn't mean that they have to accept that. Just because they say our Medicare rate for a knee replacement is $14,000, that doesn't mean that they'll accept $14,000 as payment in full. That just means that's what they accepted from one payer. Because most hospitals are paid by multiple payers, Medicare, Medicaid, VA, the five insurance companies, cash, foreign people coming in and paying the full charge master, because there's so many different prices, it's undefined what they should post. My personal feeling is what people should post is exactly what Dr. Keith Smith posts, and that is, here's what I'll accept. Here is my price. It's $14,995 for a knee replacement. That's it. That's what I'll take. You come in, you write a check for me, bang. It's all done. So that is my opinion of what should be posted, but there is discrepancy across the map. If anything, my feeling is that legislated price transparency leads to additional confusion. It doesn't clear it up. It just makes more confusion.
Thank you for that question, and thank you for the answer there, Ralph. Sure. So we do have some more questions in the Q&A box, a couple of related ones. Mm-hmm. And they're related to using Medicare's quality metrics for ranking doctors and facilities. So this doctor says, most docs believe those ratings to be a farce. Mm-hmm. The high quality doctors are those who cherry pick the easy cases and refer out the hard cases. The low quality doctors tend to work at tertiary referral centers, which undertake the tough cases.
I don't disagree at all with that comment. The reason that I posted those prices is I was attempting to get the state of Tennessee to pass a law that would remove the Blue Cross PPO. What they reported on that $1.6 billion of paid claims, they reported that the in-network providers were paid X percent of Medicare and out-of-network providers were paid 6% less. So my legislation said, if the network providers get 6% more and we're paying for the use of the network, why do we need a network? Let's remove the network. 6% of $1.6 billion is $96 million a year. So let's just take this out. This is a no-brainer. And then, of course, a lot of people said, well, yeah, but if you pay less, you're going to get lower quality. Now, you know, again, as I discussed earlier, I don't think that there's a person on this call that would disagree in general, not 100% of the time, but in general, an experienced doctor can perform a procedure in less time than you did just out of medical school. And therefore, when there are additional costs, such as, you know, facility fees, you know, et cetera, it could actually reduce the cost by having an experienced doctor, just like experienced lawyer and experienced accountant, everything else. So what I was trying to demonstrate, and I agree, CMS quality ratings are not great, but that is the sort of widest spread. You know, I don't think it's impartial, but it is, you know, the public is led to be impartial. And the CMS ratings, I think, are better for hospitals than there are for individual physicians, because each hospital every year has to fill out like a 100-page survey that talks about their mortality, their morbidity, their readmission rate, you know, even how many times a patient has dropped off the gurney. All of that stuff is reported, and that all gets added into the CMS quality ratings. So again, it's not perfect, but if we just wait for the perfect quality matrix, we'll just be waiting and waiting and waiting. So I just said, hey, this is here right now. It is generally pretty well known. Every hospital that takes Medicare, which excludes, again, Keith Smith, but every hospital that takes Medicare has a CMS rating. So what I noticed is that the higher cost ones were, you know, also rated as lower quality.
Thank you for that question. Thank you, Ralph, for that explanation. Yeah, I understand that, you know, that's a metric that's available, and you know, maybe it does provide some information that's usable. I just, from a free market standpoint, I would love to see, you know, some more free market metrics out there that measure maybe what's the quality, that's the metrics that are important for the patient. And ultimately, it's the individual patient, to me, that will make that quality judgment. And another bone I have to pick, I'm not picking on you, Ralph, and I appreciate what you said there, but just about the CMS metrics is sometimes they do punish hospitals that are trying to do the right thing for patients, like the readmission metrics, the readmission penalties. So I guess it's one thing to disclose what their readmission rates are, and then the person can make their own decision about what that means. Right. But then to penalize the hospital for readmissions has unintended consequences. Like one study recently in a peer-reviewed journal showed that it's leading to higher cardiac deaths for cardiac patients. The readmission penalty is, you know, discouraging hospitals from readmitting patients that really need to be readmitted. Anyway, all right, no, thank you. That's some difficult, lots of problems here when the government gets involved.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. All right, thanks for indulging my two cents there. All right, so that kind of leads to another question we have here is, how is value of care measured? Well, that's a very good question. I think we discussed that a little bit
in
the last few minutes, but any other thoughts on that?
Well, you know, again, there are so many different modalities. If you go through an insurance doctor, and I hate to use that term, but if you just go to Blue Cross and you say, hey, doc, my knee hurts, you know, the four most expensive words in healthcare are go down the hall. You know, just go down the hall, get an MRI in the medical center. It's going to cost a whole lot. And they'll usually say, well, I don't know, look in the directory. I've actually talked to people that have gone to a Dr. Adams because Dr. Adams was the first one in the directory. They didn't flip to page two or page three. So Dr. Smith would have been on page eight. So, you know, they actually select doctors based on that. So the incentives are askew. And again, it's because the insurance companies make profit. The more you spend, the greater their profit. So how do you measure value? You know, that's a difficult question. You know, if you're given a budget, if you're told the value based on the median charges for a given procedure, you'll get that plus 25%. Go wherever you want. And if you get it done for less, then great. Just like if I say, hey, Jeremy, I'm going to buy you lunch and I send you a check for $30. If you go to Wendy's and pay 10, you keep the 20. And if you go to Ruth Chris Steakhouse, you pay another, you know, 50 on top of it. So I think we're all entitled to make our own decisions. We just have to decide what the value. And unlike Ruth Chris versus Wendy's in healthcare, again, you know, as I've been trying to, you know, demonstrate, there's often an inverse correlation.
Thank you for tackling that. All right. And I forgot to mention that if you're dialed in on the phone, you can hit *9 to raise your hand. So if you're on the phone and would like to verbally ask questions, *9 will indicate that for us. And in the meantime, we have a number of questions over here in the Q&A box. And this doctor asks, do you support health savings accounts tying money to the person, not the state or insurance company? And then the second part here is the suggestion here is everyone gets $3,500 a year from birth in index fund with no investment decision possible by the owner. Die healthy at 90, the heirs get $2 million. That's interesting. I think I've heard Ben Carson suggest something sort of like that, maybe not exactly. Anyway, what are your thoughts, Ralph?
Yeah, I mean, it's like privatizing privatizing pensions, privatizing Social Security. I think in the long run, we would be far better off without Congress raping the funds and using them to build bridges to nowhere and stuff. I think we would all be better off. There will be those people that exceed those. But for the largest part, I think most people will be under. And again, as I talked about those two slides on Milton Friedman, I mean, I've got them framed in my office and I look at them every day. And if you understand those inherently, then you'll really understand the incentives and perverse incentives in healthcare. We spend our own money very efficiently. And when somebody asked me, hey, Medibid, I mean, the insurance company should love it, you know? And I said, no, it's different. If you go to Priceline, you're spending your own money on a flight. If you go for a knee replacement, you're spending somebody else's money. So the incentives are almost inverse. So we've got to get to that median, and putting $3,500 a year into that health savings account is a great way to do it.
Very good. Good points. Thank you. Thank you for the question and thank you for the answer there. And we'll move on to the next question in the Q&A box here. This is another $1 million question, $1 billion question, $1 trillion question, maybe. How do we get to price transparency? I guess legislators think it's through mandates. Legislators and CMS bureaucrats think it's through mandates.
I think we should mandate smiling too. and I've said that before. You know, if we mandated happiness, we're going to get a bunch of plastic smiles, you know. So how do we, the first thing we have to do is define transparency. I'm not a top-down type of guy. I'm not the kind of person that that thinks that government is the be-all, end-all, you know, solver of healthcare. But if a hospital or a physician or a surgery center post prices, I think that the prices that they post should be, this is what I'll accept for as payment in full for this procedure, barring complications, like Keith Smith does. I think that would be a good path to transparency. So it's just defining what price you have to pay, and I think it's the price that you would accept. So if St. Thomas chooses to post their charge master, and St. Joseph's chooses to charge their Medicare, and neither one will accept that, what does it give us? It gives us nothing. We've got to say, post the price that you will accept for any patient walking through that door. Again, barring complications. I know that somebody that's you know, 350 pounds and 5 feet tall and hypertensive and a smoker and diabetic is going to cost more, because their procedure needs to be done in an inpatient facility versus somebody that's 185 pounds, you know, et cetera. I understand that, but there's gotta be some way to say, just post what you would accept in 80% of the cases, barring complications.
Right, right. And you know, I guess another way to ask the question is, why isn't there transparency? I mean, in almost every other industry, there is transparency that matters to consumers. I mean, no one has to mandate the grocery store to put prices on things. Consumers demand it and it happens.
Right.
So
here's why I believe there is no natural transparency. If there were natural transparency, it would lead to competition. Insurance companies, specifically the PPO part of the health insurance game, basically prohibits competition. They've got these behind smoke-filled room deals where they say, okay, you know, mark up your price to 10 times what Medicare pays you, and then give us a fake 75% discount on imaging and a fake 25% discount on surgical procedures, you know, et cetera. Again, which leads to discrepancies. Just across the street, St. Joseph to St. Thomas Hospital will have huge discrepancies in pricing. So, you know, it's with the insurance companies, they don't want competition. Then people would actually say, hey, what do I need insurance for? If I can get a knee scope for, you know, $3,600, what do I need insurance for? People think they need insurance because they think a knee scope costs $24,000. And they think that an MRI costs $6,600 and you know, a colonoscopy costs $7,000. They buy insurance because they have this conception of what it costs. So by that opacity and the lack of a true, you know, level playing field in terms of posting prices, the insurance companies, I think that they get people to believe that they need insurance because the prices are much more than they really are.
Right, they scare them into thinking it. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. I think it boils down to third party payment. I mean,
yes,
when people are spending exactly their own money, schemes like this get squeezed out by competition.
Right.
And someone else paying the bill leads to all kinds of
problems.
So, all right, we'll go to some additional questions here. This is an interesting one. This doctor says, I'm a plastic surgeon and very accustomed to the beauty of retail medicine. I've always thought that we could do what Keith Smith has done on a much larger scale across all specialties by creating a separate system that parallels and eventually replaces the current system by exposing its faults and making it obsolete, a la Buckminster Fuller.
Right.
What will it take to get something like this done? Or asked another way, what are the major hurdles to creating such a system? I've heard a number of doctors ask that question in the past. I mean,
And that is a great question. Plastic surgeons and LASIK surgery, things that aren't covered by most health plans, competition exists. We've seen the cost of LASIK surgery come down and the quality go up, because it's not covered, because there's true competition. Why can't Keith Smith does post prices. It's taken him a number of years to build, to the point where he doesn't need third-party payers. The problem is most people are insured through, you know, usually one of the big four big five insurance companies or Medicare, Medicaid, or the VA. 85%+ are, you know, insured through them. So most of them, if they went to Keith Smith for a knee replacement, most insurance companies would consider that out of network and charge double the deductible. Why? Because they make less money, so they want to discourage it. So let's talk about some of the solutions. One of the things that we've been doing a lot of, okay, and I know there's going to be some people that argue this, and rightly so. There's a thing called reference-based pricing, okay? Back 20 years ago, there was a thing called indemnity plans where the insurance company just paid, you know, whatever was billed, or actually they billed 80% of usual and customary charges. Reference-based pricing is relatively new. What reference-based pricing does is it takes a reference. The most common one is the Medicare rate, plus 30%, 50%, 70%, whatever. Keith Smith and I have had this discussion. He says the Medicare rate's arbitrary. It's not based on anything. He's 100% right. I agree with him 100%. Okay, again, I also agree that the CMS quality ratings aren't great, but it is the widest known reference that is relatively stable. So if a health plan says, look, you can go anywhere you want, anywhere you want. We've got 85 companies that are on a plan of reference-based pricing, everything from a MEC plan to a mini-med to a major medical, plans that cost $50 per employee per month to plans that cost $300-$400 per employee per month. So what that plan does is it says we will pay a maximum of, for example, 150% of Medicare. So if Medicare would pay $15,000 for knee replacement, it'll pay up to $22,500. What we do is we say, okay, if you get that procedure done for less than 22.5, then you can pocket half of the difference, okay? So we actually provide an incentive. If you get it done for more, then you pay the difference. You can go anywhere you want. Now, if every single person in this country was covered by that kind of plan, we would have true competition because people would actually be looking for that price transparency. We all know Keith Smith is a quality facility in Oklahoma, Surgery Center of Oklahoma, top quality, the best doctors, fair prices, reasonable charges. Facilities like that already are thriving on a small scale. If we had 100 million Americans on reference-based pricing, it would be huge. It would be widespread. So that, again, I agree with Keith that the Medicare rate is arbitrary. It's pie in the sky. But right now, for the marketplace out there, stop-loss underwriters need to underwrite a maximum risk. And that's one that they know. That's one they can open a manual and give a price on. Normal reference-based pricing, what they do is they say, just go anywhere you want. And if you go to Vanderbilt, you're going to get a balanced bill. And then we'll fight it on the back end. I don't agree with that kind of reference-based pricing. Except as it relates to an ER visit, what we do at Medibid is we say, hey, look, this is the maximum. If you get it for less, we'll give you a cash reward. We'll send you $1,000 in the mail for getting it for less than that maximum charge.
Right. Thank you for the discussion on this. Yeah. I mean, there's all kinds of downstream problems that have occurred because Medicare started fixing the prices, you know, about 30 years ago now. And it's created a number of distortions that we're all paying the price for.
Absolutely.
Okay. So that leads to the next question here. That's just coincidentally the next question up here in the Q&A box. Is there a way to find out what Medicare pays for office visits and procedures? And go ahead.
Yeah. You know, and one of the things that has been done in the last 4 or 5 years is Medicare has actually become more transparent, which is, I believe, a good thing. I because it is the government paying. It's our tax dollars, but the government is administering or paying that to physicians. I think that should be 100% transparent, how our tax dollars are spent. Is there a way to find that out? It's kind of complicated. If you Google, you know, what are the Medicare reimbursement rates for a 99-213 or, regular office visits, you can find it. You can find it. The AMA, who gets paid, I think it's up to about $80 million a year right now to administer those tables, those CPT code tables and stuff. They don't want to show it because they want to lease out their payment schedules. But Medicare itself, CMS.gov, is getting more transparent. Now, I think there is, the last time I checked, and this was, a while ago, but there is a limit as to how many you can look up. The complicated part is you have to look up a CPT code, a DRG, a revenue code, all these, different billing codes. So it's not easy, but it can be done.
And thank you. I am putting a couple of URLs in the chat room here to some of those tools you mentioned, Ralph. Mm-hmm. There is, CMS does have a CPT code rate finder where you can plug a CPT code in and plug your region of the country in, and it will spit out the price for you. Mm-hmm. It will tell you Medicare's allowed amount. And then there's also now, thanks to the Trump administration, there is a Medicare procedure price lookup where it will tell you the facility fee for any given procedure at a hospital or a hospital and a outpatient surgery center, mm-hmm. a surgery center. So it will compare the rates for you.
And Jeremy, one of the things about surgery centers, let me just talk about that for a second since you brought it up. Medicare has two kinds of rates that they pay for a surgery center. There's HOPD rates and non-HOPD rates. HOPD, and I forget what those initials stand for. If a hospital owns a surgery center and it is connected to that hospital by one brick or more, they can charge HOPD rates, which is 40% more than if that ASC is not connected or is privately owned. So, again, it's a scam. It's a scheme to charge more for the same thing and to inflate costs. But, that's another thing in regards to transparency and stuff.
Yeah, I think it's hospital outpatient department.
Oh, right. And, right. Yep.
And there are, CMS and Congress. I think Congress actually passed a law a couple of years ago that's trying to make the payments more site neutral, although it's limited in scope and there's a number of lawsuits. And I've lost track of where the lawsuits are right now, but of course right. The hospitals are suing over that. So,
yeah. I'm just going to change the battery in my headset. I'm just going to be blank for 2 seconds.
Okay, we'll let you do that. We don't want you to run out of juice there, Ralph. And so there was a question about will this be available afterwards? Yes, we'll be sharing the link to the video.
I'm back.
Oh, good job. That was quick. All right. And okay, so let's tick down we have a few more Q&A questions and discussion typed in the box. And again, if you like to raise your hand to ask a question, please do that, or *9 on your phone if you'd like to speak and you're on the phone. Okay, so this doctor makes this point, complications matter. If patients knew hospitals were getting rid of physicians and replacing with non-physicians, there would be competition. It's coming, but how many people have to suffer and die in the meantime? Yeah, this is a big debate about physicians being replaced by
PAs and nurse practitioners and stuff. Yeah. And I'm sure everybody on this call probably shares my opinion on this. Nurse practitioners and PAs, in my experience, tend to prescribe a lot more expensive testing. A good experienced physician is just going to cut to the chase, especially if that's your family physician that you've been seeing for 10, 20 years, as opposed to going to a nurse practitioner or PA. The insurance companies, will bill sometimes the same rates for that PA, but again, they're more profitable for them because they prescribe all of these tests, and they often will miss something. And because they're so afraid that they might miss something, they overprescribe tests. So, this is one of these things where there's no perfect answer. It's just one of these things where, we've got to just, competition will solve it. How do we get competition again? Reference-based pricing is right now the best thing that I know that's allowable within current legislation, within the current law, that can be done. And again, I want to just mention this really quick. On a self-insured plan, you don't have to offer the 10 essential health benefits. You just have to offer minimum essential coverage. So you could design a health plan to cover as much or as little as you want. For example, you could say, I want to carve out mental health completely. You could say, I want to carve out, prescription drugs, completely, or at least specialty drugs or whatever. So on a self-insured plan, there's a lot more latitude to design health plans and to design a reimbursement schedule than you can on a fully insured state regulated plan.
Yeah, and thank you for the innovative work you've been doing in that area, Ralph. It's very helpful. Thank you.
Sure.
And you're just touching on the NP versus physician question. I think that's you mentioned the over-testing. And I think that's one reason Medicare now is instituting this thing they call AUC, not to be confused with AOC, but AUC, appropriate use criteria. They're going to be requiring every person who orders a test, an advanced test like CT scan or MRI or nuclear medicine, to use Medicare's algorithm, plug in the patient's information into Medicare's algorithm, and Medicare will spit out whether it thinks you're ordering the right test or not, and it will suggest what it thinks the right test is. And if you order too many tests that aren't the right test, you'll be put on Medicare's bad doctor list, consequences are unknown at the moment for that. But perhaps one of the reasons is all the, doctors are being punished for all the tests non-doctors are ordering that may not be appropriate. Okay, so let's see, we'll move on here. Here's an interesting point. This doctor notes that accrediting agencies, I guess you mean like the Joint Commission, set a bottom of cost because of the standards they set for hospitals that are unproven standards. So for instance, it makes it a lot more expensive to build a hospital than it otherwise would be. Mm-hmm. He's saying a room in a psychiatric hospital costs $100,000 to build, while a room in a luxury hotel costs $30,000. So 30%, and the cost difference he's suggesting is due to standards like those imposed by the Joint Commission. Yeah, that's interesting.
Well, that's interesting, and that $100,000 in California is $200,000, not just because of the cost of labor and the cost of real estate, but because of all the earthquake, stuff like that. I have a friend that builds hospitals that says, in California is twice as much. Again, it's because of these crazy standards. So if you have a plan that pays, for example, reference-based pricing, 150% of Medicare for a knee replacement is $22,500, you might not go to California because it's more expensive there. You might go to Vegas, Phoenix, even Reno instead, because it's less expensive because they have different standards. That would address the competition. And eventually people would stop building hospitals in California with their new wealth tax, 13% they're taxing. I mean, they're trying to empty the state as it is. Why not empty of hospitals? And I don't even want to get to the, CON laws, the, certification of need for hospitals. That's a whole nother webinar.
Right, there's all these government-granted special favors that hurt hurt the patients. I mean, right, and I think, the Joint Commission is basically, is granted a monopoly by CMS to create these standards. So,
mm-hmm. Right.
The government's given, although I think they have opened the door a little bit to competing accrediting agencies, but for a very long time, the Joint Commission had essentially a government-granted monopoly to set whatever standards it wanted to, and they had the force of law, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, let's move on here. So we still have about 15 minutes and a few more questions, so we'll tick through these. And very interesting questions. Thank you, everybody, for the robust discussion here. And okay, so this doctor says, for lab testing, insurers will negotiate fees/payments. For those lacking insurance, labs will charge the charge master price 10 times or more than the negotiated price for those with insurance, and will dun and pursue payments from the person least able to afford them, and will ruin their credit rating, hound them, say $100 for a $10 CBC, for example. So the price is not the price. Yeah, that's a problem. That, although I think there are a number of labs now that do offer really upfront cash pricing. And here in Arizona, patients can order their own tests now and find a number of labs that offer cash pricing. Any thoughts on that, Ralph?
Yeah, again, there are so many millions and millions of variables, and sometimes the reason that legislators and employers and insurance companies and everybody else gets stuck in the weeds because there are so many gazillions of variables. That's why I just say, look, let's just forge full speed ahead. I don't agree with Medicare rates, but right now it's the, I don't want to say the gold standard because that's not at all true, but it's the widest known standard that we can hang our hat on. So let's just start there and let's just see what it does. Let's just increase competition. Because once you get rid of that in-network, out-of-network thing, you'll get rid of that same thing with labs where they're charging $100 for a $10 lab, and stuff like that. A lot of people that I know do reference-based pricing wrong because they sign a bunch of direct contracts and then they say, we're going to pay 150% of Medicare. Okay, great. Then that's what I'll charge. Prime example of that. Every time on Medibid that somebody requests a knee replacement, we get usually 17 bids on a knee replacement from across the country. Every single one from California is always exactly $30,000. Never $29,000, never $31,000. Because CalPERS pays $30,000 for knee replacement to their state for their state employees for knees and hips. So every facility in California, ASC hospital, charges $30,000. So setting that and having a direct contract brings everybody up to that ceiling. Having competition and bidding allows people to compete.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Answer there. All right. So let's see, another interesting question. Do you plan to sell your company to eBay or Amazon to get it scaled up?
That's a really interesting question. We have heard from, a very interested potential investor. I think eventually what I would like to do is, you're right, an eBay, an Amazon, a Google, not Blue Cross. Blue Cross is not our friends. That's not where I would ever want to get investment money from. I'd want to get it from IT, not from healthcare. So that's a great question. And, right now we're small. We're a tiny little, we've got about 390,000 patients that use us actively. But we'd love to have millions and millions. But to get there, we do need the money to scale up. So, yeah, if anybody's got a few million dollars out there, give me a call. Or if anybody knows somebody at Amazon or Google.
Excellent. Okay, so, all right. I don't see any hands raised, but there's still a number of questions here in the Q&A box that keep coming in, and we'll get through as many as we can. So this doctor says, as I have thought about the problem of overcoming the insured barrier to a free market medical system, I believe that it will take convincing a gigantic self-insured employer to help create it. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking Amazon, JP Morgan Chase, Berkshire Hathaway, the the effort they're undertaking and the Haven project. Does anybody know what they're thinking? Yeah, that's another great question. Have you heard any rumors about what they're actually going to do, Ralph? JP Morgan Chase, Berkshire?
No, you know, I haven't. And I think that, you know, again, because there are so many, you know, people that are bringing up so many questions that people are just saying, well, you know, I don't get it. And, you know, again, Priceline, when they started, their model was pretty simple because it's people spending their own money. When you're spending somebody else's money, how do you motivate the person? There have been a number of people that have, you know, emerged in the self-funded space, but they're all narrow networks. And a network by any other name is still a network. And it still, you know, causes an increase in costs. So, again, we need true competition. That's why we've been fighting this fight for 11 years now, you know, getting people to compete. As we get more money, then we can get more, you know, patients and more physicians and increase the playing field. And you're right, getting a jumbo employer, and we've talked to a few. We've talked to the state of Tennessee, the state of Texas, the state of North Carolina. We're talking to the state of Washington. We're talking to some large employers, including Philips, that has 20,000 employees in the U.S. So, but you need money to tackle those big, huge patients. But, you know, just like what Keith Smith is doing is great. It's fantastic. I wish we could clone him, you know, 100,000 times, you know, all across the U.S., one by one, as we grow, as we get, you know, more investment, as we increase our technology and reach out to more employers, we will, you know, continue to win this fight. But it's just battle by battle by battle in the trenches.
Good point. Good point. Thank you. Yeah. And I don't know, one interesting thing about the Haven project, the JP Morgan Chase, Berkshire Hathaway, is, you know, they initially hired Atul Gawande as their, you know, chief medical officer. And recently he quit or left. And now I think I just saw Biden picked up Atul Gawande for his COVID task force. And of course I first learned about Atul Gawande when he was involved in Hillary Clinton's healthcare plan. He was one of the architects of that. Okay, so, all right. Here's another question. Do you have a citation for the more frequent testing by NPs? No. I think I brought that up, and
yeah.
I did a quick Google search, and so the top hits on that are actually blaming doctors for ordering too many tests, too many expensive tests, and saying that nurse mm-hmm. practitioners are not as likely to order the really expensive tests. I mean, I'll have to dig into that a little more. Well, maybe the expensive tests are called for sometimes. And
yeah, I mean, sometimes they absolutely are. And I think also young, and I don't mean to, you know, discriminate against the young, but people just out of med school. You know, you can do, you know, like a 420 slice CT. I mean, that's great. That'll show, you know, like, so I think that they're sometimes overly anxious in prescribing this, sometimes for the good, you know, sometimes for good reasons. So I don't want to bash it and say, stop prescribing these tests. But, you know, by the same token, you know, don't get to the point where it's like Canada, where they're rationed. But also don't, you know, over subscribe because, you know, again, many of these are unneeded. So, you know, again, I don't know if there's an actual empirical study. Anecdotally, I think that I've heard many stories, yeah. But I think if there was a story, they'd hide it.
Right. So, right, a lot of the publications that are popular on Google probably were written by people who have, you know, trying to push a certain narrative. So, and there are probably studies that show whatever conclusion you prefer, you can probably find a study to support it.
Right.
Ultimately, I think, you know, there should be transparency and patients should know who's directing their care and have a choice, mm-hmm. have a choice of an informed choice.
Right.
Okay. We have about four more minutes, and we'll do a couple more questions here until we run out of time.
Okay, and I've got a short little 2-minute video at the end too.
Okay, so we'll maybe take one more question here, and then we'll do the video. Okay. And if we didn't get to your question, just reply to the follow-up email, and we'll try to get to you. I really appreciate all the great discussion and questions here. So, all right, this is an interesting one. How much of the physician shortage do you think is real, and how much?
Let me try to answer a couple of them really, really quick,
because
my video is just not really an important
one. Okay, yeah.
I'll show it after the end if anybody wants to see
it. Okay, yeah, we can see if you're willing. We'll stick around a little
Sure. So I think there's a shortage in primary care physicians, in family doctors, internists. That's my opinion, because the specialties are paying much higher. That's my opinion, but I'm sure Jane would know a whole lot more about that than I would.
Yeah, so she's also suggesting it's the documentation mandates that's decreasing efficiency.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, yeah, that has nothing to do with it. And again, it's, you know, the government controls the residency slots, the number of residency slots. And so it's they're creating the short. Any shortages are
the interesting thing is I recently looked up, you know, primary care doctors per capita. The US, Canada, and UK are actually fairly similar, believe it or not, but specialists per capita are much higher in the US versus Canada or the UK. ICU beds are way higher as well.
Okay, yep. Thank you. So another question, why would a hospital fee be 30 times versus a surgeon's fee for a cochlear implant, but only 3 times higher the surgeon's fee for other more challenging middle ear surgery reconstruction?
Because they can.
Yeah, okay. And yeah, maybe the implant cost factors in.
Well, I mean, that's probably a tiny bit of it. You know, it's because of the lack of competition. That's the simple answer.
Yep, okay. Yeah, and this doctor
comments. I like this question. Who should be making the decisions about medical care? This is more corporate medicine. No, absolutely not. The person that should be making the decisions is the individual. If Jeremy needs a knee replacement and he's told you get up to 22.5, go wherever you want. If he wants to go to Thailand, to India, to Cancun, to Phoenix, to Houston, that's his decision. He should be making that, not corporations. I think this is a repeat of the last question, or very similar. Let's see here. Again, you know, why do hospitals charge more? Why do surgeries charge less? It's because there's no competition. That's the bottom line.
Right. Government price setting. I mean, because the government sets the prices for one higher than the other for arbitrary reasons other than value to the patient.
What if we move to Medicare for all? Well, I left Canada because of Canada, they call it Medicare, and it covers 96% of the population. So there's only 6% uninsured rate, but there's also rationing. And I recently helped a Dr. Lee Crisco, Jeremy, who you know. Lee had a friend who is a cardiologist in Thunder Bay. His brother had an extremely rare form of bladder cancer, and there was a drug that he could not get in Canada. It passed phase 2 trials in the US, and they just approved it. They just said, okay, it's good to go. Long story short, we got him that in Duluth. He couldn't get in Canada. So when you have Medicare for all, especially single payers they have in Canada, North Korea, and Cuba, you're going to get shortages and rationing. And unfortunately, because there's so many millions of variables, eventually people say, you know what, I give up. The insurance companies, which they consider to be free market, which they're not, are screwing it up. That's when we're going to get the push.
Yeah. So then this, there was a second part of this question. How will, if we do get Medicare for all, how will that impact deep direct primary care practices and transparency? Well, hopefully we wouldn't become like Canada, North Korea, and Cuba and prohibit it. It would be more like England where it's still allowed. Although that, I mean, I'm not suggesting we go to the British system, but Ralph, there was a British Columbian surgeon who sued Brian Day.
Brian Day, yes.
Did he lose? I thought I heard he lost his case recently.
They're suing him all the time. There's Jacques Choly, who you remember, he was at Salt Lake City with us at the APS meeting. Brian Day is another friend of mine. He's a British orthopedist, and he's got the Canby Clinic in Vancouver, and he always changes his model. The government's always two steps behind him. He's got some really good lawyers that allow him to kind of create loopholes and stuff. You know, up in Canada, where my mom lives in Kelowna, there's a very, very large Native Indian tribe that was going to open a hospital on Indian land. Which would have been exempt from the Canada Health Act. It never went through. I'm not sure what happened there, but that would have been great too.
Yeah, good point. So here we got, I think we touched on this a little bit earlier, but maybe not exactly in this way. How do we get rid of the pharmacy benefit manager safe harbor for otherwise illegal kickbacks and bribes? Well, yeah.
Well, okay, so the bill that I wrote in Tennessee, okay, we got really, really, really far with it. We got through three or four committees. It just sailed through, and then the COVID shutdown. I wasn't able to get there to testify. It was killed in the last committee. And what I heard from two different sources, okay, was that the big insurance companies approached the Republican leadership at the state level and said, if you guys ever want to get a campaign contribution again, you will kill this bill. Okay, so this question is talking about bribes and stuff like that. I think that they are rampant, I think the five biggest lobbying groups in the country, not in this order necessarily, but the five biggest are big hospital, big pharma, big insurance, the AMA, and the NRA. Again, not necessarily in that order, but the healthcare lobbyists just have such huge lobbying power that they will prevent either party from ever doing anything that makes sense.
Right, right. Yeah, and I know, you know, one of Chuck Schumer's biggest contributors, so I've heard, is the Greater New York Hospital Association. And apparently the hospitals get kickbacks from group purchasing organizations, which are mm-hmm. kind of a cousin to PBMs.
Right.
And there's a lot of people who are trying to push for the getting rid of their safe harbor in the Medicare anti-kickback statute,
right,
which would otherwise prevent kickbacks. But there's, right, just like you said, Ralph, I mean, it is very difficult to get the legislators and to agree to do that because they get so many contributions from it too.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. Let's see here.
I think these are just kind of repeats and comments. Yeah. So let me just go ahead and show the little parting video here. Let me just share my screen again. Where am I? Which one?
Number. Okay, so there's a green button down at the bottom. Share screen.
I see it. Yep. I see it. Okay.
Make sure you click the audio.
Wait. That's right. Let me just see your screen sharing. Where do I do that?
If you click screen sharing again. If you click the screen sharing button again, then you should see it. Or if I kick you out of screen sharing, you can do it.
Yeah, do that. Yeah, go ahead. Kick me out.
Okay. So now, click the share screen.
I see. Oh, I see. Yeah, it is clicked. It is clicked.
All right. Oh, good.
Remember. Okay. So there we go. Is it showing?
Let's see. I see it. No, I'm seeing your last slide there.
Okay. That's, is it, as long as it's showing that screen, just hang on. Let me just bring this over here. Oh yeah, it's Adrian's birthday. Happy birthday, Adrian.
That's my wife. She's not here. She went over to her parents.
Okay. So here now, this is something. Yeah, this is a COVID self-test. Okay. And I think it's highly recommended.
We don't see it. We're not seeing it.
You don't? Okay,
no, just wait. I think you may need to close PowerPoint.
Oh, okay. Oh, right. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, maybe close PowerPoint.
Close exit PowerPoint.
The slideshow.
Okay, and share screen.
Yep.
Whoops. Just wait. Wait. I don't know where that sound is coming from.
We don't hear
okay.
it.
Okay. You don't? Okay, good. Yeah. So let me go ahead and share this. Tell me if you can hear this.
Okay. Yep.
Well, thank you very much.
Hey, lovelies. Listen, so I was just watching old Dom Rab on the television admitting that testing's no good and it's all a shambles and that essentially, what did he say, Chris? 93%
false
positives. Oh, yeah, we're getting 93% false positives. He said it live on television. So I just wanted to reach out to you and say, we've got to do this ourselves, guys. You know, test yourselves, stay vigilant, stay safe, take care of yourself. You can't rely on those tests out there. And even if you could rely on them, you can't get them. So all I'm doing is I just want to reach out to you and say, you know, you've got to do this yourself. So the most, probably the best way you can test yourself is, you know, to basically take a, probably something like a glass of wine or a beer or a whiskey. And then what you do with it is you, if you can smell it, you probably don't have COVID, but you probably want to, just to be 100% sure, you probably want to drink it. And if you can taste it, then you probably don't have COVID, but they do say that the more tests you can do, the better. So I'm thinking every night, I don't think I have it, but it's really important that you stay vigilant and stay safe. So I tested myself 45 times last night. And what I found was I woke up, I felt fine actually. I was really good last night when I did that. But when I woke up in the morning, I kind of had a sore head and I didn't feel great and I had the sweats. I thought maybe I'm coming down with something. So I've stayed vigilant all day and I'm going to stay on it and I'm going to keep testing all day because I did wake up a bit sweaty and headachy. So I'm just going to keep testing all throughout today. Yeah, still don't have it. Yeah, I can still taste that. So if you can smell and taste and you can do that over multiple tests, I would say you're okay. Cheers, guys. Keep testing. Stay safe. Be vigilant. Bye.
There you go.
I don't know. I think
do you endorse that?
Fauci might want a randomized controlled study for that.
So there you go. There we are.
Okay. All right. Hey, thank you very much, Ralph, for the fascinating presentation and the discussion. I really, sure. really appreciate all you're doing and you're
happy to be here
with us tonight. And so with that, I will just go ahead and wrap up and let's see, is there anything I need to remind you of? I'm grateful for all the attendees. Thank you for being with us and for asking all the great questions and raising all the wonderful points. And just a quick reminder that in about 30 minutes, I'll be sending out the post-event email, and hopefully we won't have the same problem last week where it got trapped in a lot of internet black holes. I think one of the reasons was I had shortened URLs in that, which I think some internet providers don't like because apparently bad guys use shortened URLs to hide links to bad URLs. So that I will not use shortened URLs. I'm going to see if that helps. But in any event, if you don't get the post event email within, let's say, an hour or certainly by tomorrow morning, let me know and I'll get that taken care of. So with that, I'll just make one more brief note. Next Thursday, we will be having our discussion forums. Our doctors are in informal discussion group. If you haven't been to one of those before and you'd like to attend, just reply to the post of an email and let me know and I'll make sure you get an invitation. 2 weeks from today is Thanksgiving. Normally we'd have a webinar, but we will not be having one on Thanksgiving. We'll be dark. But then on December 3rd, we'll be back and have a very important presentation by Melanie Sturm, who is an expert in crafting messages that persuade, and that's going to be even more, that's important and will likely be especially important in the coming months as some really, really important healthcare policy battles are fought. So you won't want to miss Melanie Sturm's presentation on the 6 powers of persuasion coming up on December 3rd. So with that, from all of us at AAPS, I wish everyone a good evening. Thank you again for being with us, each and every one of you.
Thanks, Jeremy. And I had a couple of comments to post it on my Facebook, and I'll try to share it on the apps page.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Excellent. All right. Very good. Good night, everybody. Bye.